during the presidential campaign, the Democratic candidate for president, the guy who won, said all the right stuff. Here's what the Democratic candidate for president said during the campaign. I'll quote him. A nation as prosperous and successful as ours must guarantee the health of all its men and women. Safeguarding health care for every American is not a sentimental wish. It's a matter of justice. The guy who won the presidential election said that. That's the good news. The bad news is the candidate who said that was Woodrow Wilson in the 1912 election. And we've been trying ever since. And as a matter of fact, in 1912, both candidates, Wilson and Teddy Roosevelt, both argued for universal coverage. And we didn't get there in part because there was a new organization then in 1912, kind of an upstart organization called the American Medical Association. And they didn't want government messing with health care, and they didn't let anything happen. And here we are 100 years later. But you know what? In a sense, I am pretty confident that we can fix American health care. I know we can do it. And the reason I know we can do it is because all the other countries like us, I mean high-tech, advanced, industrialized, free market democracies, all of them have faced the same problems, and they've all found ways to solve them. All the other rich countries provide health care for everybody of high quality, and as Ian just showed us, they spend half as much as we do in the process. How do you do that? How do they do that? Well, you know, I got so interested in this topic, I set out about 3 years ago to write a book about it. I thought this would take me a year and a half. It took more than 3 years. It's a big job. But I did go around the world. I went to the doctor in 10 countries to find out what the care is like, how they treat you, who pays, how much it costs, things like that. Because I was trying to answer this question, how do they do that? How do they cover everybody and not spend much? And you know what? I think I figured it out. I think I've got it. And as Ian said, I have a book coming out, and it's coming out in a month called The Healing of America, which I deal with this question. But along the way, I found out that there's a more important question. The most important question isn't how do they do it. The really important question turned out to be why do they do it? Why does a country make a commitment to provide health care for everybody who needs it? Or another way to ask that question is, how come the richest country in the world has never made that commitment? And I deal with that in the book, too. So here's what I'm going to do right now. I'm just going to take you very quickly on my tour around the world. We're going to take a look and see what I found when I went to these other countries. And I'll tell you right now my hidden agenda. I have a cunning scheme. And the cunning scheme is they only gave me 40 minutes for this, so I'm going to have to race through this stuff. And my plan is that you'll say, boy, that's really interesting. I wonder if there's a book about that stuff. Let's hope. So what did I find when I went to the doctor and all the other industrialized countries? Well, first of all, let me tell you what I didn't find. In a way, that's just as important for Americans to know. In the first place, it's not all socialized medicine out there. As a matter of fact, a lot of rich industrialized democracies provide universal coverage with private doctors, private hospitals, and private insurance plans. In fact, in about 5 minutes, I'm going to argue to you that some of these other democracies are less socialized than the United States of America. Second, guess what? It's not all single payer. You can cover everybody in a coordinated, organized system of care at reasonable cost without having a single-payer plan. Single-payer is a bad word in America. It polls very badly. It kind of, you know, it suggests big government, nanny state, communism or something. No, it doesn't have to be that way. Switzerland is a country of 8 million people, 70 insurance plans. Germany has 240 different health insurance companies. Japan, which has the best health statistics in the world, an aging population, fantastic health statistics, massive consumption of health care. In Japan, the average hospital stay is 36 nights. In our country, it's 6. In Japan, when you have a baby, mother and child stay in the hospital for 10 days. And still, They spend half as much as we do per capita, but it's not single payer. Japan has 3,000 different insurance plans, but they get it done. So I'm going to try to, it's not all single payer, it's not all socialized medicine. And finally, this is important, they're not all the same. This notion that you go overseas and every country has government-run in healthcare and everything's the same, no. No, as a matter of fact, all the countries do it differently. They've all faced the same problems that we do. They all face the same basic decisions. And guess what? They all come up with different answers and different solutions. For example, I don't know if I mentioned this, but I have a book coming out this summer. It's called The Healing of America. And in this book, I raise the question of which countries cover Viagra in their basic formulary. You know, if a pill is covered, if a drug is covered in the basic formulary, then that basically the health system pays for it or it's very cheap. And some countries have decided that erectile dysfunction is a serious problem that has to be treated in the formula, and some don't cover it. And I talk about this, and it's kind of a surprising answer. You know, our family lived in Britain. We were in the National Health Service, which is, you know, it's good health care. I'll talk about it in a minute. It did fine for our family, but I think it's pretty stingy. There's a lot of stuff the NHS just won't cover. They just don't pay for that you would think was normal in America. But for some reason, think about this, the British system covers Viagra. Yeah. Now, why would that be? Yeah, I know what you're thinking. No, that's not the reason. The reason is a British scientist invented Viagra, and they're proud of this guy, so they're going to put his pill on their formulary. But you go 25 miles away across the channel, and the French system won't cover Viagra. You can get it, but you have to pay a lot out of pocket to get this pill. And I was in the health ministry in Paris talking to a woman there, and I, you know, had this long list of questions. I'm a reporter. That's what we do. And I said to her, so how come you don't cover Viagra on your basic formulary? And this woman says, "The French men, they do not need Viagra." Anyway, so my point is they're all different. They've faced the same questions and they come up with different answers. So if you look at the World Health Organization, they have 192 member nations. You can never really tell how many countries there are in the world because at any given time, some peninsula or some island has seceded from the country and put up its own flag and declared its independence. But let's take the World Health Organization. They say 192 different countries. And fortunately for my publisher, if you want to see how healthcare works around the world, you don't have to go to 192 countries. I mean, the book was expensive enough for the publisher. This is why we hope somebody buys it. But no, as a matter of fact, the countries, and I specifically focused on rich democracies like us, where we could learn something, they fall into different categories. There are models of healthcare around the world. And so here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to tell you the four models of healthcare that I found going around the world. And of course, there are variations. They're not all identical. But and some healthcare economists look at the same group of countries I went to and see six models. Some see three models. But I'm going to tell you four models of healthcare and how they work. And one of the things I want you to pay attention to as we go through this is the question of who's the provider of care and who's the payer of care. We'll look at the providers and payers, okay? So I'm going to start with the Beveridge model of healthcare. This model is named for Lord William Beveridge. He was a Brit. He was a classic British type. He came from the titled landed gentry. His family was just rich as all get out. They owned mansions everywhere, huge staffs and everything. And Lord Beveridge grew up in splendor and went to Oxford. And then this is kind of standard. This is not unusual among rich landed titled gentry in Britain. He then devoted his life to helping the poor. He just got into that. He went down to East London to help poor people on the streets and became a famous social reformer in Britain. He founded the London School of Economics. He did a lot of things and was quite well known in Britain for his work trying to help the other half. And here's what happened. Near the end of World War II, Winston Churchill figured out that the Brits were going to beat the Germans and win World War II, and he was a far-sighted statesman and was actually thinking about what Britain should look like after the war. And he assigned Lord Beveridge, William Beveridge, to do a study of British social services for the second half of the 20th century. And Beveridge published this famous report. The Beveridge Report is a hugely popular, successful report. And the key of it was, he argued that healthcare for everybody from a landed, a titled gentry like him to a starving guy on the streets of East London was the government's job. That is, healthcare was a government duty just like putting out fires and running the parks and collecting the trash. When you need the service, you go get it and you don't pay for it. Of course, they pay for it. They pay through it through taxes, and the taxes are pretty high. But in the Beveridge model, nobody ever gets a doctor bill. In fact, in Britain, 97% of the people in Britain go their entire lives and never get a doctor bill, never get a hospital bill. They think that's normal. They can't understand why we want to put up with all this paperwork. That's a good question. And in this Beveridge model, the government is basically the main provider of medicine. The government owns all the hospitals, it owns all the labs, it employs all the nurses, it employs many of the doctors, but not all. And government, of course, is the payer because there's no bill. It's just done as a government service. So government as the provider and the payer of health care, I'd say that's pretty close to socialized medicine. When our politicians rant about socialized medicine, it's bad for us. I don't have any problem saying the NHS is socialized medicine, but you know what? When my family was there, it worked pretty well. I mean, you live in Britain, your child has an earache, you call the doctor, at 1 o'clock in the afternoon, she's at your house, they make house calls, takes a look, talks to your daughter for a while, comes out and says, I believe it's otitis media, I'll give her a penicillin jab. A jab is a shot. Gives her a shot. My daughter feels better already. She knows she's going to be better. I feel better. The doctor says, yes, would you ring me tomorrow at 10 and give me a report, right? And then she's out the door. No bill. No three-month fight with the insurance company over who's going to pay the bill. What's not to like? I like the system. And as a matter of fact, they cover everybody. They have better, slightly better health statistics than we do. And they spend half as much. That's the Beveridge model of healthcare. It's used in Britain, of course. It's used in Spain, Italy, New Zealand, Hong Kong, and Cuba is a classic case of where government owns everything and employs everybody and you never get a bill. The Beveridge model of healthcare, it's pretty close to socialized medicine. But the next model I'm going to tell you about is kind of the mirror image of the Beveridge model. I just want to say one more thing about the Beveridge model of healthcare. If you have that system where government's in charge of everything, you get a lot of control. You get a lot of control. You know the reason doctors make house calls in Britain? Is because they make £20 or $26 more per call if they go to your house. And it's worth it to them. Quite often their patients, particularly in London, are within a few blocks. You want more house calls? Fine. The system pays for them and you get them. We all know that in the United States we have a serious shortage of primary care doctors. This is true in a lot of countries. It's not only our problem. But Britain, 64% of the docs are primary care doctors. Why would that be? Well, the system decided they needed more primary care doctors, and in Japan, a family doctor makes twice as much as a cardiac surgeon. Guess what? 65% of them are family docs. So you see, the system gets some control if you do it that way. Now I want to move on again, as I said, to the next model, which I think is the mirror image. This is the Bismarck model of healthcare. This is named for Otto von Bismarck. He was the Chancellor of Prussia in the 1860s, and in 1871 or two, he unified a whole bunch, maybe two dozen German-speaking fiefdoms and principalities and states into a new nation called Germany. Prussia had been the biggest piece of it, and he now was the first chancellor of Germany. He was the first chancellor of Germany. He was also the fattest chancellor of Germany. I don't know if you've ever seen a statue of Bismarck. He's kind of a blimp of a guy, and he looks ferocious. He's always seen in his Prussian army uniform. He's got this 8-foot sword here. He's got a spiked helmet on. He looks tough as nails. But as a matter of fact, Bismarck was a warm and fuzzy kind of guy. You wouldn't think that, but Otto von Bismarck, the first chancellor of Germany, invented the welfare state. And the reason he did this was he was trying to convince all these somewhat reluctant new Germans, Frankfurters, Alsatians, Bavarians, that they really were members now of a new state run out of Berlin, and that there were, you know, he had to give them some benefits. So he invented the welfare state and started sending everybody money from the government in Berlin. First of all, he invented Social Security. He invented the government-paid old age pension in about 1874. We got around to that in 1934. Then he invented workman's compensation. If you got hurt on the job, the government paid to treat you. And that worked pretty well. So in 1881, he invented a national health care system where everybody had access to health care. And he did it in an interesting way. He did it through insurance companies. In the Bismarck model, everybody gets health insurance from a health insurance company, and you split the premium with your employer. Sometimes 50-50. It depends on the region in Germany. In some places, the company is required to pay 70 or 80%. But this doesn't sound unfamiliar to you, does it? This is the Bismarck model. Everybody gets health insurance through the employer. Employee and employer split the premium, and the insurance company pays the doctor bill. In this model, I said it was the mirror image of Beveridge for this reason. In this model, the docs are private, the hospitals are private, the labs are private, and the insurance plans are private. This is not socialized medicine. In fact, in Germany, for example, well, let me give you this comparison. In America, just about everybody, way over 99% of Americans, when they turn 65, switch to government-run health insurance under Medicare, maybe with a private supplemental plan. In Germany, everybody stays with the private insurer cradle to grave. This is less government-run, less socialized than the United States, in my view. And yet the Germans cover everybody and spend about 70% per capita of what we spend on health care. That's the Bismarck model of healthcare. And get this, in the Bismarck countries, this is going to be hard to believe, but people actually like their health insurance company. They have rules there. They have rules that limit the administrative costs an insurance company can run up. They have rules about how fast the bill has to be paid. In France, which is a Bismarck country, the insurance company has to pay the doctor or the hospital within 3 days. Anybody have that kind of performance here? If you're the patient being reimbursed, they have to reimburse you within 2 weeks, but the doc gets paid in 3 days. Get this, in Switzerland, the health insurance plan has to pay the claim within 5 days. If they don't, your next month's premium is free. Anybody in this room have that deal with their health insurance carrier? That's the Bismarck model, and because they have pretty strict regulation of these private insurance plans, they've made insurance work better than I believe it does in the United States. And then the third model is a mix of the two. In the third model, I call this the national health insurance model. The providers, the docs, hospitals, labs, et cetera, are private, and the payment scheme is public. I call this the national health insurance model because there's a government-run national health insurance plan, and the paradigm case is Canada. In Canada, everybody pays either, some provinces call it a tax, some provinces call it a premium. I think premium is a better idea. I mean, you're buying something with a premium. And anybody in Canada can go to the doctor for free. And the national health insurance plan, which is called Medicare, by the way, pays the bill. In this plan, as I said, it's a mix of Beveridge and Bismarck because the providers are public. The payer is public and the providers are private. And basically, it works pretty well. I bet you've all heard horror stories out of Canada. And you know what? Most of them are true. In my book, I have a book coming out, and in this book, I'm pretty tough on Canada. My chapter on Canada is titled, Sorry to Keep You Waiting. Because what they've done in Canada is, in order to save money, to keep costs down, they have deliberately limited the number of surgeons, of operating rooms, of almost all medical specialties, of scan machines and everything, so that you wait a long time to get these services. And they did that on purpose to save money. It's not a bad model because for acute care, everybody is treated. Anybody who needs acute care in Canada gets it. But if your medical problem can wait, you wait. Now, in my case, I went to this fantastic doctor, wonderful doctor in Saskatoon, Saskatchewan, wonderful guy. And he saw 44 patients in a day, just ran them through. And of course, there's no billing. All he does is, at the end of the month, one person in his office, he's got nine physicians in the practice, guy sends a tape to the government, and that's it. That's all the billing he has to worry about. And it was interesting to see. But then I said to him, look, doc, I got this bum shoulder. I hurt my shoulder in the Navy. It hurts every morning when I wake up. I can't get a wine glass off the top shelf anymore, And he, palpates me and does all that stuff that doctors do. And he says, yeah, you've got an orthopedic problem. I'll refer you to an orthopedic surgeon. It's a gatekeeper system in Canada. You've got to go to the GP and get a reference before you can go to the specialist. Well, that's okay. I don't mind that. I have to do that with my insurance in America. And how long will it take to see this specialist? 10 or 12 months. 12 months. 12 months, but it hurts me every morning. I don't want to wait 12 months to get treated. It's going to take me a year to get my shoulder treated. And the doctor said, oh, I didn't say treated. No, it'll be 12 months for the consultation. If he wants to treat you, that'll be another 6 or 8 months before an operating room comes due. So when you hear these stories about Canada, it's true. But that's not a function of the national health insurance model. As a matter of fact, several countries that use that Canadian model, South Korea, Taiwan, for example, Australia, have shorter waiting times for elective surgery than the United States. So it's not a built-in problem, but they build it in Canada to save money. That's the national health insurance model. So I've given you three, the Bismarck model, the Beveridge model, and the national health insurance model. And those three kind of cover the waterfront of rich countries. But the fourth model is by far the most common model in the world. It's only about the richest 40 or 50 countries in the world have any kind of healthcare system at all. For the other countries, the healthcare system is very easy to describe, and the term for it is out-of-pocket. This is the out-of-pocket model, and you can figure it out. If your kid is sick and you have the money to pay the doctor, you can get her treated. If you don't have the money in your pocket to pay the doctor, your child stays sick or dies. It's simple, it's brutal, it's a fact of life in about 150 of the world's countries. This is the out-of-pocket model of healthcare. And an interesting transition has been that in the 90s and in this century to some degree, as countries have gone from poor to rich, particularly these new industrialized tigers in East Asia, many of them have moved out of out-of-pocket healthcare into an actual healthcare system. And interestingly, most of them have chosen the Canadian National Health Insurance model as their model. Taiwan, South Korea. And get this, as of January 1st of 2010, next January, our neighbor to the south, a country of 100 million with one-fifth the per capita income of the United States, is going to have universal health care in Mexico, and they adopted the Canadian National Health Insurance model to do it. They're going to beat us to universal care. How does that make you feel? Anyway, in the out-of-pocket model, as I say, if you have money, you pay, but you don't need money. People pay in whatever they've got. They pay in potatoes. You weave a rug for the doctor's office. People make a desk or make a chair for the doctor's office in return for getting healthcare treatment. I went to this clinic in Nepal, up in northern Nepal, north of Kathmandu. There aren't any roads. You walk everywhere. And I walked, you know, I walked 2 or 3 hours up a steep, steep path to the top of this hill. And on top of the hill is the plainest, just drabbest rectangular building you've ever seen. It looked like an outhouse, except it's a little too big to be an outhouse. That's the medical clinic for an area of 100 miles or so. And totally drab, plain, ordinary building, except all the walls were a different color, bright color. So I go in and I'm chatting with the doctor, and I said, do your patients pay you? He said, well, I eat a lot of potatoes. And that chair over there was made for me by one of my patients. You know, he treated the patient. The patient went home, built a chair, and then walked 4 hours back up the hill to deliver the chair to this guy. And he said, you know, a lot of people, I mean, there's some level of respect in paying for the service you get. So people like to pay me. And a lot of people have a can of paint at home. So they come with a can of paint and say, I tell you what, in return for your treatment, I'll paint your clinic. And they all have a different color. So this is the out-of-pocket model of healthcare. So now I've given you four models. We went around the world very quickly, and I gave you four models of how foreign countries do healthcare. Now, don't tell my publisher this, but here's what I found out at the end, after I had done all this expensive travel. You don't have to go around the world to see the four models of healthcare, because right here in the United States, we've got them all. We've got them all. If you are a Native American or a veteran or active duty military personnel, well then for healthcare you live in Britain. The Veterans Administration is the NHS. It's the beverage model of healthcare. Government-owned facilities, government employees providing the care, government buys the pills, and you never get a bill. That's beverage model. If you're a working person who's getting insurance through the employer and splitting the premium with your insurance, well then you live in Germany. That's the Bismarck model of healthcare. Today, about 155 million Americans are using the Bismarck model. We know that model. If you're over 65 and you're getting your insurance through a government program called Medicare, well then you live in Canada. That's the national health insurance model. 44 million Americans are on it. And if you're one of the 40-some million Americans with no coverage, well then you live in Madagascar, or Malawi, or Mali, because that's the out-of-pocket model, and 40 million Americans are in that model, and you guys know this because many of them with nothing in their pocket come to your hospitals and expect to get care. And we force you to shift that cost somewhere or just bear the cost. We have that in the richest country in the world. We have tens of millions of people living on the third world out-of-pocket model. So we've got them all. But here's the important point. This is the crucial point. All the other countries have decided to put everybody into one model. Now, maybe they're beverage country. Maybe they've looked at it and decided that the Bismarck model or the health insurance model is best. But everybody else has put, all the other countries have put everybody into the same system. Some countries have a military medical corps, so if you're a soldier overseas and you know, you get shot or you get sick, you go see a military doctor. But as soon as that British lieutenant goes home from Afghanistan, she's in the NHS with everybody else. There's one model for everybody. That's really different from the United States. Well, you guys know this. You have whole floors of people trying to figure out which system to build, because we have so many different models and systems and rules and everything. And some people think this is the American way. Last year I covered the John McCain campaign, and every once in a while somebody, McCain would get talking about health care, and somebody would say, well, here's what I don't get. How come all the other countries manage to cover everybody and give them good care and spend half as much as we do? How come they can do it and we can't? And McCain had two answers for that, and I would argue to you that he was half right. First of all, he said, well, you know, it's un-American. You know, that's all socialized medicine over there. As you know, I think that's wrong. Some countries are socialized, but some countries are less socialized than we. And then he said, and anyway, those countries all have one-size-fits-all medicine. Everybody's in the same system. Who would want to do that? And, you know, I think he's right about that. That's right. They do have one-size-fits-all medicine. Now, why would you want to do that? And when I went around the world to write this book of mine, I asked the health minister in every country, why does everybody have to be in one system? Why do you want one-size-fits-all medicine? And here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to tell you the answers they gave me, and you can judge whether you think these reasoning is legitimate. Okay? Why should everybody be in one system? Well, in the first place, it's just so much simpler and therefore so much cheaper if you have one set of rules and one set of forms, and in many countries there's one set of prices, or just at least, I think in Germany they have 14 different regional pricing areas. You go to the doctor, I don't know, I'm sure this happens in your hospital, but when I go to the doctor, if the doctor says I need anything serious, and I say to her, well, what's it going to cost? She says, gee, I don't know. What plan do you have? Doctors don't know what it's going to cost to get a procedure done in America. I don't know if your hospitals know. You go to the doctor in France, and she's required to have on the wall a chart showing the price she's going to charge you for the 100 most common procedures that she performs. It shows what she's going to charge, it shows how much your insurance plan is going to pay you back, and it tells you how long it's going to take for insurance to pay you, which, as I say, is about 2 weeks. This is set because they know, because they have one set of rules for everybody, and the result is you save tons of money at this. Now, you know, we're Americans, we tend to think that free enterprise, competitive markets are the most efficient way to do anything. It doesn't seem to work when it comes to health insurance. As I'm sure you know, well, you know this better than I do, the American for-profit private insurance companies are the least efficient payers of health care in the world. They have the highest administrative costs in the world by a huge margin. You look at these statements, that, you know, there are a lot of different numbers about their administrative costs. I am a reporter, so I tend to look at documents, and you go to the Securities and Exchange Commission, and these are private companies. They have to file quarterly with the SEC, and they include something called medical loss ratio, which is what their administrative costs were, and they range from 18 to 25, 28% every quarter. Depends on the company and the quarter, but in that range, they're adding 20% of cost to every bill they pay. And I've asked them, where's the value added? What are we getting for this 20% that you add? Do you guys know the answer to that? I've never gotten a decent answer to that. Well, it's difficult. This is complicated. It's hard to pay for health care. It's very complicated, you know. Yeah, okay. So you go to Canada. You remember I mentioned Canada's National Health Insurance Plan. Their bills are paid by the government. That is lazy, overfed, inefficient, unmotivated government bureaucrats, right? Their administrative costs are 5%. Britain, I told you, has one system for everybody. Administrative costs, 5%. France, anybody here see France as a model of management efficiency? 61 million people, 14 health insurance plans, administrative costs of 3.1%. Because they've got a unified system. The world champion in this area in keeping administrative costs down is Taiwan, which, as I said, is a leaner version of the Canadian system. In Taiwan, when they set up the system, they wrote into the law the administrative costs can never be more than 3% of intake. And as a matter of fact, it's averaged 1.7%. 1 year, the administrative costs in Taiwan went over 2%, and the opposition party trashed the government for wasting money. Now, you know, we'd like that problem. I'd take it. So, and the reason is you get administrative simplicity if you have one model for everybody. So this is one reason you want to do this. Another advantage that these health ministers told me of covering everybody in the same system is you get an economic incentive for preventive medicine, or what you might call public health. There is value in keeping people healthy. There is value in preventive care. We all know that. But it costs money. Somebody's got to spend the money to do it, and you need an incentive, an economic incentive to do it. Well, in our system, where people change their insurance carrier on average every 4.8 years, the insurance system really doesn't have an incentive. They've got to pay a quarterly dividend to their investors. Why would they spend money to keep you healthy? By the time you get sick, you're going to be the next guy's problem. In fact, a lot of those latent diseases won't show up till the person is 68 or 9, and then they're Medicare's problem. But in other countries where they have everybody cradle to grave, they have an incentive to keep people healthy. And in my view, the world champion in terms of preventive health is Great Britain, the system I told you about. You walk down the street, anybody here lived in Britain? My family lived in Britain for several years. You walk down the street in London and there's a huge billboard. Does your back hurt? Call this 800 number. We'll send a nurse over free to look at you, check you out. There's a TV ad we used to see all the time, and in this TV ad, mom is stirring this big pot on the range, you know, she's making dinner, and it's, you can just tell it's one of those disgusting British dinners, porridge, you know, or Marmite, ugh, you know. And the kid's saying, Mom, how long before dinner? And she's stirring away. And Mom says, oh, just Mom, are you okay? Oh, yeah, no, don't worry about Mom. Nothing to. And then the announcer says, is Mom coughing a lot? Could be chronic bronchitis. Call this 800 number. We'll send a doctor to your house to check it out. There's this, you get a flyer on the street. Do your feet hurt? Could be a serious problem. Call this number and we'll send a podiatrist to your home. You walk down the street, Fifth Avenue, Oxford Street in London in October, and they have a bunch of people in American cheerleader outfits out there, you know, with pom-poms and sweaters and these pleated skirts, you know, not what you would expect to see on Oxford Street in London, very American. And the Brits find this incredibly sexy, you know, these pretty American girls, and I do too, I've always found that. Anyway, you go up to this British cheerleader with her pom-pom, what are you cheering for? And she said, well, it's October, have you had your flu jab? Have you had a flu shot? No, fine, just go in that door right behind me, it's free. It's free. Now, there is medical care, and this happens all the time in Britain. And I said to the health minister, one of the health ministers under Blair once, I said, geez, you know, I like living in your country because I just have this feeling that a bunch of smart, dedicated people are working really hard to keep me healthy. And here's what he said. He said, yeah, of course I do that. I'll tell you why. He said, from the minute the line turns blue on your mother's pregnancy test, until the minute you flatline in a hospital 90 years later, you're my patient. Of course I want to keep you healthy. Now, one of the striking things about this is a lot of the major breakthroughs in preventive medicine are American ideas. This is our technology and our science, and I argue in my book that the other countries have done a better job of implementing it. Let me give you an example. One of the really great breakthroughs in preventive health was the tobacco, the cancer warning on a pack of cigarettes. Let's see if we can get this to work. Well, I'm trying. That's not it. No, I went through too fast, so. I lost them. Yeah, that's backward. Okay, we invented this in 1966, and there you see the warning. I just want you to take a look. On the front and the back of the pack, it says Marlboro or Camels taste great or something, and there's the warning on the side. Cigarette, Surgeon General's warning, cigarette smoking causes carbon monoxide. I guess that's bad. 100 countries around the world have copied this American idea. And frankly, they make our warnings look like a powder puff. Let's take a look at the warning in Britain, which just flashed by. Now, there's a tobacco warning, and the rule in Britain is the warning has to be on white black letters on a white background on the front and back of the pack. And this is so successful that they use it in all the European countries. Here's a French pack of cigarettes, Fumare Tue. In Italy, it's Il Fumo Uccide. Il Fumo Uccide. In Germany, to me, German is a scary language because my mom was German, and when she got mad at us, she would lapse back into German. Rauchen ist tödlich. Rauchen ist tödlich. Smoking is deadly. And for some reason that I haven't figured out, if you go to the other German-speaking country, if you go down south to Austria, they've toned it down a little. In Austria, it says, Rauchen kann tödlich sein. Smoking can be deadly. So my thought kind of is there's some trucker carrying a load from Munich, Germany, down south to Salzburg, Austria, smoking along the way. And as long as he's in Germany, he's a dead man driving. But if he can just get across the River Salts, he's got a shot at it, right? You know, smoking can be deadly. Here's another really good European one. This is Romania. Smokers die young. Now, in my view, and believe me, I've studied this, the world champion on tobacco warnings is Canada. Canada, one thing they do is they put, of course, both in French and English, they put these disgusting anatomical pictures of what happens to you if you smoke. Here's one. That's your heart. There's a hole in your heart you got from smoking. They have one that shows the smoker's teeth, and they're all brown and rotting and falling out, really disgusting. And then here is the world champion cigarette warning, I think the best one I've ever seen. And that one is, they call that the limp penis picture. They just put it in last year. I was in Ottawa, and I was at the health ministry, and the guy's talking to me. I said, boy, you have really good tobacco warnings. He says, oh, you got to see my new one. It's great. You're going to love it. So I went down to a 7-Eleven. Cigarettes cost like $8 in Canada, you know. And I said to this kid behind the clerk in the 7-Eleven, I need a pack of cigarettes. What brand? Oh, I don't care about the brand. I just want the good warning, you know. So the kid goes back, and he's looking through, and he says, oh, God, I didn't know that, you know, like that. And he sells me this pack of John Players and says, that'll be $8.79. You know, and I bought them, and I said, you know, I really only want the pack. I don't want the cigarettes. Kid says, I'll take them. So there's a degree. How far does this go? We don't know. Okay, so this is another reason you want one-size-fits-all medicine. It's cheaper and simpler, you have an incentive for healthcare, and then the third reason, and all the health ministers agree on this, they think it's fairer. They think it's fairer if everybody has access to the same care at the same price. And that's an important kind of switch in my talk to you. I've been trying to be an objective reporter and tell you the strengths and weaknesses of these different systems. But once you get to a word like fair, or just, or decent, or moral, we're not in the realm of objective reporting anymore. These are subjective questions. And you know what I found out? This is the most important point. This is the first page of my new book. For any country, the design of a healthcare system is a medical question, obviously. It's an economic question. It's a political issue. But primarily, every country's healthcare system is a moral issue. It's a moral question. If you make the moral determination that everybody in your country who gets sick should have access to a doctor or a hospital, well, then maybe you design a system like the ones I saw in Britain or Germany or Japan, where everybody can go to the doctor, rich or poor, old or young, healthy or not. And if you don't make that moral determination, well, then maybe you end up with a system like ours, where certain people get the best health care in the best facilities in the world tomorrow morning with no waiting. And yet, according to the National Academy of Sciences, 22,000 Americans die every year of treatable diseases because they can't afford to see a doctor. That's where we stand now. And the striking issue is, why is it that the richest country in the world has never made the moral commitment to provide health care for everybody who needs it. And my view is the determination of what's going to happen this year in the United States is going to turn on that moral question. Will we make the decision that we want every one of our fellow Americans to have access to a hospital when she needs it, access to a doctor when she needs it? And I'm now going to summarize for you. I'll summarize my entire book in one sentence. I just want to say this does not give you a free pass. You still have to buy the book when it comes out in August. But the fact is, if we could find the will to provide health care for everybody, if we could find the will, the other rich countries can show us the way. Thank you. And I do have, I think I have about 15 minutes for questions, if anybody has a question. Yes, ma'am.
Hi, I'm Lindsay Gaynor from Boston, Massachusetts. Could you talk a little bit about how countries in the Bismarck system cover people that aren't employed?
Yeah, that's a great question. So the Bismarck model is you share, you get insurance through your employer, and you share the cost with your employer. What if you're not employed, or what if you're self-employed? They have made what seems to me to be the most sensible possible decision, except one that we never made, and that is when you lose your job, you do not lose your health insurance. Seems so basic. Why? Who would have thought up a system where you lose your job and then you lose your health insurance? But basically what happens if you lose your job, then the government plays the role of your employer and pays that half of the premium. If you have too little money to pay your half, the government pays the whole premium. They're viewing unemployment as a temporary condition, and as long as you're in it, they're going to help you keep the same health insurance you had before. But you don't lose it. And that, why would, I mean, of all the cruel, strange twists of America's healthcare system, why would we take away health insurance at a time people need it most? No other country does that. Yes, sir.
Most physicians in America are concerned about tort reform. How do the other countries handle this issue?
Yeah. Every country has to have a mechanism to compensate patients who are damaged by doctors or hospitals, you know, either just by accident or through just sheer negligence. And then you need a mechanism to discipline the doctors that let this happen. But no country does it through the tort system. No other country has decided to do that. They have visiting doctors. In Germany, a doctor from a different part of Germany comes into a dermatologist comes into a dermatologist's office for a week, talks to patients, goes through all the records, calls some patients at random, and looks at any complaint that has come in, and then they decide on what kind of compensation the disciplinary system is required. In Britain, they have an interesting system. They have this organization called NICE, the National Institute for Health and Clinical Excellence, and NICE sets procedure standards, how everything should be done. It tells doctors and hospitals what procedures are okay and how they should be done. And if the hospital can say, we followed the NICE rules, then you're immune from suit, regardless of a bad outcome, if you follow me. Another key point is what we see in America are these huge judgments. As you all know, most malpractice cases, the patient does not win. But when the patient wins, there's a huge judgment. And that's often because the judgment includes lifetime care, lifetime medical care. And that's expensive as hell in America. If somebody is awarded lifetime health care in Britain, it's free. They weren't going to pay for it anyway. In Japan, in Germany, in Taiwan, it's cheap. And therefore, even when they get a judgment for lifetime care, the cost is much lower than in the United States. But we're the only country that relies on the tort system as the kind of disciplining mechanism.
Yeah. Hi, Ken Sands from Boston. You've made a good case for administrative simplification as a reason why these other countries save money. But a lot of the costs in the U.S. is considered to be based on overutilization. Can you talk about how utilization differs in another country under a Bismarck model, say, and if it's different, why?
How do you control utilization? How do you get at that 30% of cost that is not providing any value? Most countries have the kind of thing that the administration is now talking about, and I see the hospital association is trying to fight, and that is some kind of central board or maybe regional board that decides what procedures are going to be allowed and which ones will be paid for. And they also set prices. Let's be frank about this. They dictate prices that hospitals can charge and doctors can charge. And that tends to be, let's be frank about it. It's a rationing program. You ration care. All countries ration care, and quite often the argument is raised in the United States, well, we don't want government-run health care, we don't want to reform health care because they'll ration health care. Hey, we already ration health care. Everybody knows that. We ration it in the harshest possible way by letting 20,000 of our fellow citizens die, by letting 700,000 go bankrupt. That doesn't happen in other countries, but they ration care. This NICE that I talked about, National Institute for Clinical Excellence in Britain, is the overutilization police in Britain. And one of the things they do is they set age limits at a certain age, and they won't quite tell you what the age is, but it's around 88 or 89. They won't give you dialysis anymore. And that means your grandmother's going to die because they just won't pay for that procedure at a certain age. And I think this is easier to accept in Britain. Nobody likes it, but it's easier to accept because at least in Britain, if the payment scheme, the NHS, won't pay for your grandmother's operation and she's going to die, at least you know the money is going to help somebody else. It's going to help some sick baby. In the United States, if your Medigap plan won't cover the operation, that money goes to the insurance company's bottom line. It doesn't help anybody else, and therefore, I think it's a little harder to stomach. I think in those countries, because everybody's in the game, it's easier to make those very tough decisions on controlling use and rationing. Yes, sir.
It's just great to hear you raise the moral imperative issue. I think the sentiment in this room has been there for a very long time. I don't know if you're telling us we've been immoral for 200 years or we're immoral now for not moving faster. My question is the BRIC countries. So we're in this great recession and potentially coming out of that new global order, and you've got those countries being watched dramatically, and it doesn't sound like you visited or you didn't mention them as part of your models. Could you talk a little bit about the BRIC nations and where they stand on this issue, particularly China?
Brazil, Russia, India, and China are the BRIC countries, and many people say that that group of countries is going to be the next set of superpowers because of economic growth, population growth. Brazil is working toward, it does not yet have, but it's working toward a national system which would be similar to Canada's. They now have it for poor people but not rich people, and say that they're going to get there and have universal health care coverage, but they don't at the moment. Russia is just a hodgepodge. Rich people get decent care, and lots of people in Russia get little or none. India is a third world country. In fact, India is a country of about 1.2 billion people. About half of them never see a doctor in their life. I mean, they may see a village healer, they may see a midwife when the woman is pregnant, but in the Indian villages, there's no care. And if you live in a big city in India, there are big public free hospitals, but you know, people wait not days, but weeks just to get into the emergency room. There are huge lines. So there's no care there. And then China, I think, is really tragic. When I went around the world, one of my experts was this great guy, Bill Shao, Professor William Shao at Harvard. And I was talking to him, and he says, you know, you really ought to go to China. And I said, no, I only want to go to, you know, free market democracies that we could learn from. He says, no, the reason you want to go to China is it's the only big one that's worse than us. And here's what happened. In China, as you remember, under Mao, there were these famous barefoot doctors, many of whom were not doctors at all, but they were junior college or maybe high school graduates who then got some medical treatment, like a medic in the Navy. and they were sent out to villages. And everybody in China for a while under Mao, this is in the 70s and 80s, had access to a doctor. And now that's considered, you know, that's not a market force. The market is all in China nowadays. And now they are a classic out-of-pocket model country. If you have some money, you can get good care in China. If you don't, you're shafted. So they're not there yet. But these new Asian tigers, for example, and as I said, Mexico, Malaysia, those countries have all adopted healthcare reform, healthcare systems, national healthcare systems, and every one of them started with the proposition, we're going to cover everybody. And then they looked for a model to do it. May I just say, you know, you mentioned the moral point. I think this moral point is the key point of healthcare. It's, as I said, it's the first page of my new book, and also the last page. One of the best statements I ever saw of it is on the website of the American Hospital Association, where it says, the healthcare system has to cover everybody, and it has to be paid for by everybody. To me, that's exactly right. I couldn't have said it better myself. I didn't say it better myself, but I think I stole that line and put it in my book right off of your website. Yes, sir.
My question, excuse me, I think in the beginning you said that the United States has the finest hospitals in the world. I think I remember you saying that, and I think that's generally recognized. And assuming that, I think it's generally recognized that we have the best trained physicians in the world.
I agree with that.
We have the lion's share of innovation in pharmaceuticals and in devices, and I would say that with respect to this group, the design and development and the kind of the workflow, the factory aspect of hospitals in this country is vastly ahead of any place else in the world. So my question is, why is that as compared to these other systems, and what's the significance of that?
Yeah, I feel very strongly. I've been to hospitals in a lot of countries, including many rich countries, and just in terms of the state-of-the-art technology, the physical facilities, the kindness, the decency, the way people treat you as a human being, I just feel more comfortable and more welcome in an American hospital than any other. And the reason for that is because we spend money on hospitals. And the other countries, many of them, the way they keep those costs down is they have very strict cost regimes. In my book, I'm quite complimentary of Japan. I lived in Japan. I like Japan, and I think that country has done a good job of solving a lot of kind of social problems. And as I said, they have the best health statistics in the world, aging population, but tremendous health statistics, and very, very good recovery rates for major diseases, better than ours. They have one-third the rate of infant mortality that the United States does. They just don't let their babies die. And yet they spend $3,400 per year per capita on health care, and we spend about $74. How do they do that? They shaft the doctors and they shaft the hospitals. And you can see this. Hospitals are borrowing money left and right from the banks. A lot of hospitals in Japan are technically in bankruptcy at the moment because they haven't put the money into them. When we lived in London, my local hospital, and we used to go over there now and then, was a famous hospital, St. Mary's Hospital. It's on Praise Street. It's right next to Paddington Station. You've probably seen it if you've been to Paddington. And you go in this hospital, you know, it's a beautiful pile, you know, it's very British. And you go in this hospital, and at the front door, there's a plaque. And it says, in this hospital, Sir Alexander Fleming discovered penicillin in 1928, right there. And guess what? They haven't painted the place since then. And you walk down the hall, and there are buckets catching rain. There are patients in gurneys in the hallway, and then right next to her is a bucket catching the leaking roof. They just haven't put in the money. And I think a lot of what makes American medicine, American hospitals so good is clearly the training of the staff, good management, but also we've been willing to spend more on hospitals than those other countries. They are chintzy about it, and you can see the result when you walk in. That's my judgment.
Hi. I have the other half of that question, which is, if you have just described where it is that we might go and the other models that other countries are following, what problems are they having at their leadership summits that they're talking about today, other than perhaps leaky buckets?
Yeah, that's a good question. Guess what? Their problems would not, probably in some areas, they wouldn't surprise you. Everybody has an aging population. All the rich countries do, and all the problems that come with that. They all have these really difficult and costly end-of-life decisions. This woman, if we did something heroic, this woman could live 8 more months, hear her grandchildren in the hallway who want us to keep her alive for 8 more months, but should we use our money to do that kind of decision? They all face the problems you do of a new pieces of technology come along that are phenomenally good and would save lives and cure people, but they're so expensive and therefore expensive to charge for. The same kind of problems you have. I think the problems they don't have are people showing up at the emergency room door who haven't ever had any health care, any treatment. I was just talking to a doctor in Columbus, Ohio. He spent 2 years at the casualty ward, that's the emergency room in a British hospital. He'd just come back. And now he's working in Columbus General, or the public hospital in Columbus, Ohio. I said, well, is it any different there? He said, well, you know, we get gunshots in America. You don't get any gunshot wounds in Britain. But he said the big difference is, in Britain, I never got these kids who came in, 18-year-old kids who came in 7 inches dilated in an active labor and didn't even know they were pregnant. That never happened because she went to the doctor. He said, you know, in Britain, when they came in for the emergency appendectomy, at least it hadn't burst yet because they'd been to a doctor when they got sick. It was free. They went to the doctor when they felt the first pain and went in and got treatment earlier. So that kind of problem you just don't have in other countries of people showing up at the emergency room door wanting what we would consider to be primary care, because in the other countries they can go to the doctor and get it. It's paid for. It's covered. And our system doesn't do that. But a lot of the problems are exactly the same. Long-term care is a problem for every rich country. The Japanese are have really serious problems with that because it's getting so old.
TR,
yeah.
Thank you so much.
Oh, yeah.
You really helped us.